Good evening, everybody. Welcome to this evening episode of Pursue. And today we have Pursue 10B, which is breast pathology. And we are streaming live from GMCH Chandigarh via Kolkata. And today we have with us Dr. Swathi Prabhu. She is an MD from FMC Mangalore and a fellow in the oncopathology from RCC Trivandrum, an expert in oncopathology. And today she will be talking in the approach to papillary lesions of breast. Presently, she is as a demonstrator in the Government Medical College Hospital, Chandigarh, and she has multiple publications in the national and international index journals. Before I ask Dr. Prabhu to start, let me request all of you to please keep your mic muted, your camera off, and please don't share your screen. With this, let me invite Dr. Prabhu. Ma'am, please share your screen and start your presentation. Thank you. Yeah, just present now. Yeah. Make it full screen. Yeah. Right, please start here. Hello, Dr. Prabhu, can you hear me?
Hello, can you hear me, sir?
Yeah, I can hear you. Just no problem. Okay. Just don't worry. Just make it full screen. No issues.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, please start.
Okay. Good evening, everyone. I'm Dr. Swathi C. Prabhu, who is working as a demonstrator in Government Medical College Hospital, Chandigarh. So today, it's a pleasure to see you all here. And so today's topic will be the approach to papillary lesions of breast. So this is 2019, recent 5th edition of WHO classification, which there is a separate category here, which is for papillary neoplasms. And this is what we are talking. So basically, we have intraductal papilloma, that is papillary DCIS, encapsulated papillary carcinomas, that is which is in situ and invasion. And then you have solid papillary carcinoma, again with in situ and invasion. And then intraductal papillary adenocarcinoma with invasion. So when you get a core biopsy or a excision biopsy and you see a papillary, some papillary structure in the slide, there's various differential diagnosis that has to come to your mind. So one is basically the papillary lesion of the breast itself as a primary lesion. The second thing that you also have to rule out, which is very rare, of course, is metastasis. So we have also, apart from that, the primary papillary lesions, then you can also have this new entity, that is tall cell carcinoma with reverse polarity, and adenomyoepithelioma or fibroepithelial tumors can also have some papillary structures or areas which might, you know, come in a differential diagnosis. I'll be dealing in depth with primary, the papillary lesions of breast. However, the rest of it hasn't been already dealt or will be dealt in the next following classes, subsequent classes. So these are the various differential diagnoses for papillary lesions. This is something I've found it on Twitter by Dr. Ahmed. So beautifully demonstrated the various lesion, just a sketch or something like a simple sketch which will give you a whole idea about the papillary lesion. So this is the normal that you have. I'll share, you'll use the pointer. Okay, this is a normal duct which has a epithelial and myoepithelial layer. Why I have drawn this hand in hand is that as far as when it comes to papillary lesion, when an epithelial and a myoepithelial cells, they are together, it mainly indicates benign nature. Okay, but as soon as it, remember I'm telling it only in this context, then as it becomes, when there is an epithelial proliferation and you don't find myoepithelial cell attached to the epithelial cell or along with it, indicates more towards the atypical or malignant or neoplastic process. So this is how a normal duct looks. Then you have intraductal papilloma, where the entire epithelium, it has become a papillae and it is attached. I mean, along with that, we can see the myoepithelial cell running through and through. Then you have intraductal papilloma with ADH or DCIS, where a small part of it, it has undergone proliferation, where there is no myoepithelial cells. Then you have papillary DCIS, where the entire papillary frond itself is neoplastic. There is no myoepithelial cells and only the periphery has myoepithelial cells. So let's start with this a little bit of introduction. We will start with the in-depth of every lesion that I have said before. We have intraductal papilloma. Intraductal papilloma, they can be either central or peripheral. Central is usually retroareolar and they present, they'll be single, they'll be large, whereas in contrast to peripheral, they'll be in the peripheral location and they will be multiple. Nipal discharge will be the most common presentation in central, whereas in peripheral, usually clinically occult, and central, they're usually seen in older patients and whereas peripheral in young. Okay. So the pathogenesis, activating mutations in PIK3CA or AKT1 pathway is seen in 20-70% of the cases. And coming to macroscopic appearance, you can see a well-circumscribed tumor or some papillary fronds which is attached with one or more pedicles to the wall. It's known to undergo necrosis or hemorrhage or secondary changes like that. And the prognosis is, when there is no atypia, the prognosis is only, in spite of no atypia, 2-3-fold risk for breast carcinoma is seen in papillary lesions. However, the risk increases to 5-7-fold when there is any atypical proliferation in the papilloma. So coming to the microscopy, see, this is how intraductal papilloma looks. You can have, it's present intraductal. So there is a duct outside and inside that there is a papilloma. So, and very obvious thing that you can see here is papillae, which is not in, it's in contrast to SPCs and EPCs, or that is solid papillary carcinoma or encapsulated papillary carcinomas, where the papillary, papillary fronds are not that evident. Whereas here, you can see the papillary fronds are so obvious. They have a fibrovascular core and this is a duct. Coming to little high power, so this is how the papillae looks. And what you notice here is they have a well-established fibrovascular core. And of course, what is the fibrovascular core composed of? The blood vessels and some inflammatory cells. What is this pink? This pink thing is they are known to undergo hyalinization. So when you see an intraductal papilloma, something that looks is it will be more of pinkish, pink colored. Okay, this is not the universal rule, but it's good to remember that. So coming to high power, what you can see is the epithelial and the myoepithelial cells. The papillae, these are the papillae, and these papillae are lined by epithelial cells and the myoepithelial cells. Epithelial cell, the luminal cells here, and the myoepithelial cells are the one which is present here with clearing. They can be cleared, they can show a little bit of clearing or spindle-shaped cells. So they run through and through the papillae. So they're accompanied by this myoepithelial cells accompany the epithelial cell throughout the papillae. So when you do a stain for myoepithelial cells, they will stain the entire papillae. So what is this? What is undergone? So this is the papillae, and what happened to this area? What we can see here is it has undergone a little bit, you know, the cells have become eosinophilic and etc. So that is nothing but apocrine metaplasia. So benign papillomas, they're known to undergo metaplasia. One of them is apocrine metaplasia. And yes, that is it. So there are some other changes as well. Like, for example, they can also undergo squamous metaplasia, especially seen in case of when there is an hemorrhage infarction in the papilloma. Now, what is this? The papilloma, you can see the periphery here, but there is proliferation of the cells. They have undergone proliferation. And this is, and you can see some slit-like spaces. And when you come and few delicate fibrovascular septae, when you do, this is nothing but papilloma has undergone papilloma with usual epithelial hyperplasia. Coming to the high power, you can see some slit-like spaces. The main thing to, you know, the morphology helps it to differentiate, from atypical proliferation. One is they have this irregular slit-like spaces. The cells are polyclonal, that is, they are heterogeneous. The cells will have, some are large, some are small. They are oriented in different directions, unlike what you see in the DCIS or atypical ductal proliferation. So here you can see that cells, there is streaming. You call it what is known as swirling and streaming, that is due to heterogeneity. And there is slit-like spaces. And these slit-like spaces, there is no polarization. So polarization means when there is a space and the tumor cells are surrounding it in a polarized manner, but it is not seen in this case. So that is how you differentiate from the atypical ductal proliferation. They're also known to have this intranuclear inclusions as seen in this picture. So the pictures are from the textbook, which I have acknowledged at the end. Next, there is one entity that is sclerotic papilloma. The one more important thing is this papilloma, they sometimes can undergo so much of sclerosis that it will abut or it will destroy the papillae itself. And the problem occurs when you take this part, or see, this is a papilloma which has undergone extensive sclerosis. This will be okay in this excision biopsy, but the problem occurs when you have done the core needle biopsies and these hyalinized areas with entrapped glands might look like a malignancy or invasive carcinoma in the core needle biopsy. It is very important to know that these papillomas, they can undergo sclerosis or hyalinization, and that might entrap the glands and might look like a invasive carcinoma in the core needle biopsy. So the well-described when you see in a low PAR, you can see the lesion is circumscribed, and when you do the myoepithelial stains, they will stain both, they will have myoepithelial cells, and they will have two types, that is epithelial and myoepithelial cells, which will help them to differentiate it from invasive carcinomas. This is another example where you can see the glands which has been entrapped by the collagen, and when you do a P63 stain which stains the myoepithelial cells, and that has stained, so it rules out that it is an invasive carcinoma. So the next thing that can is we have learned about the usual epithelial hyperplasia, how it will be. Then there is something known as papilloma with atypia and DCIS. The atypia and DCIS mainly they're differentiated by the size. The size is differentiated, like we have to differentiate atypia from DCIS when DCIS is low grade. So whatever be the size, and if the DCIS component is high grade, then we have to label it as papilloma with high grade DCIS. So the size criteria comes into play only when there will be, the low grade DCIS is present. So WHO 2019 classification 19 says that, recommends that less than 3 millimeter when you see an atypical ductal proliferation or atypical areas, you call it as atypical ductal hyperplasia. And if it is more than 3 millimeter and the nucleus is low grade, you call it low grade DCIS component. So that's what I said. And it is nothing but there will be monotonous proliferation of cells. These cells have undergone the there is a monotonous proliferation of the cells due to monoclonal the genetic features. And once there is atypia, the risk increases to 4 times or 5 to 7 times. So this is the same thing which I, you know, the same picture. So atypical ductal hyperplasia, this area has undergone atypia and there will be no myoepithelial cells here. So when you use the myoepithelial stains, there will be no stain. No cells will not take up the myoepithelial markers. This is the, what is the morphological features? Is that they will have punched out edges, punched out lumina, which is very, you know, characteristic feature of atypical ductal hyperplasia. Then the cells, when you come to the cells, they will be monotonous. They will not be heterogeneous as we see in case of usual ductal hyperplasia. And they will be polarized. That is, they will be, you know, they look, there will be, the cells will be polarized towards the spaces. And that is how you differentiate it from the usual ductal hyperplasia. Very punched out lumina, no polarization. The cells are monotonous. They have a round hyperchromatic nucleus, and depending on the size you can divide it into atypical ductal hyperplasia or DCIS if it is more than 3 millimeter. So here the size is more than 3 millimeters, so it is atypical ductal hyperplasia, DCIS, which is shown in this picture. And you can see the monotonous proliferation of the cells. So these are the various markers. This table I've taken from WHO, and these are various myoepithelial stains markers that can be used to stain the myoepithelial cells. They will have their own pitfalls or some drawback. So it is recommended that we use 2 stains at least, so that it will help to overcome their each other's deficiency. So the one that we use most commonly in our lab as well as is P63 stain. P63, it's a nuclear it's a transcription factor, so it's a nuclear stain, and it stains the one set. Drawback is that sometimes the papillary carcinomas, they take up the nuclear stain of P63. So that is one thing we have to remember. And the other one is calponin and SMA. I told you the papillary fronds, they have vessels, isn't it? The vessels, you know, the endothelial cells and the vessels pericytes, they might take up this stain and might confuse you when you're looking it. So see that always compare it with the normal or the slide that you have given for IHC. And these, however, it is easy to differentiate because the endothelial cells, you know, the small vessels, they'll usually be round, whereas this myoepithelial cell, they will run along the papillae. Then we have smooth muscle myosin heavy chain, and which is the drawback of this is it is reduced in case of sclerosing lesions. Then you have the CK5x6 and CK14, which is a high molecular weight cytokeratins, and it's not specific for myoepithelial cell, but it says that it helps us to differentiate between the ADH or ADH and UDH. So that I will explain later. One more thing, the point I want to tell here is on when there is an epithelial and myoepithelial cell, if myoepithelial cell requires an epithelial cell to survive, okay, but if there is any change in the epithelial cell, for example, if there is an apocrine metaplasia or if there is any hemorrhage or necrosis, the myoepithelial cell also dies. So we should be careful while interpreting these stains. We have to see the morphology, compare it with the the slide that we have given for stain, and then you have to interpret, see if there are vessels or see if the epithelium has undergone any changes. That is the reason we are getting low myoepithelial stainings. So all these things has to be considered before interpreting the stains, IHCs. So this is aberrant the P63, which was done. This is the myoepithelial cells which has taken up, but here you can see that even the papillary nucleus has taken up the stains. Now, using these 2 markers, you can differentiate usual ductal hyperplasia from atypical ductal hyperplasia. So, as I told before, in case of atypical ductal hyperplasia, it is a monoclonal proliferation, isn't it? So, it is monotonous. So, there will be diffuse, strong ER positive in case of atypical ductal hyperplasia, but it will be of variable intensity in case of usual ductal hyperplasia. And then when you do CK5x6, it will be taken up, mosaic pattern. Most all the cells, they take up CK5x6 if it is usual ductal hyperplasia, whereas the only the myoepithelial cells at the periphery here has taken up this CK 5/6, which so basically you can use CK 5/6 and ER to some extent to differentiate between the usual ductal hyperplasia and atypical ductal hyperplasia, because sometimes the morphology is very used in the morphology alone, it's very difficult to differentiate them. Again, I'm stressing on the point of using, see, this is polarization where you can see the cells here, isn't it? They're arranged away from the this lumina, where this is not seen in case of usual ductal hyperplasia. They'll be randomly arranged. This ER demonstrates beautifully, and here you can see high molecular weight cytokeratin, which stains only the myoepithelial cells. Now, coming to the certain changes, or there are changes that can happen in papilloma, and it can lead to a potential diagnostic pitfall. Like, you can give a papilloma as invasive carcinoma on the small, especially this happens in case of the core needle biopsies. The changes that which we have to remember is, one is sclerosis, as already told you before, the sclerosing papilloma. Next is infarct and necrosis. These lesions are known to undergo infarct and necrosis and might undergo squamous metaplasia. So, and that area, when you biopsy and you see only squamous metaplasia, you might think, oh, am I dealing with metaplastic carcinoma? And then one important thing is epithelial displacement. So this is very, very important, because epithelial displacement is when you're pulling, you know, the lesion along the core needle biopsy, or you're taking the core, what happens is some of the epithelial cells, they get displaced and they move into the stroma, and that might look like your, you know, and that comes in the biopsy and you might see, oh, this is malignancy. So this is a grave mistake. And so we have to be very careful while interpreting these papillary lesions. And the squamous metaplasia, as told before. So all these things can mimic an invasive carcinoma. So this is an area where you can see it has undergone hemorrhage and necrosis. And this is the area which has undergone squamous metaplasia. So you see, imagine looking at this in the core needle biopsy, and you have no clue that it is papilloma. And then you see this area. So it might lead that, you know, you might think that you might give it as malignant. This is one more area that is, I was telling you about this epithelial displacement. So in epithelial displacement, you'll see this is a lesion, and along the track, some of the glands have displaced. And here also, which is, you know, almost near the skeletal muscle. So this looks like it is malignant, but look for other features, like if there is an areas of fibrosis, or if there is an areas of hemorrhage, or if there is any cholesterol clefts or hemosiderin laden macrophages. All this helps us to differentiate whether we are dealing with malignancy per se, or whether we are, you know, looking at the epithelial displacement. And one more thing is, you can use myoepithelial stains, and they will have myoepithelial along with them. But the problem occurs if the papilloma is, you know, having a DCIS or atypical ductal hyperplasia, and that component goes into the stroma, then you will not see the myoepithelial cells. So basically, in that cases, the morphology helps us to differentiate whether it is actually a malignancy or whether it is just an epithelial displacement. And that, again, you have to look for features. And that is, this is a picture that is P63, which is staining the, you know, the displaced epithelium staining the myoepithelial cells. The thing that you usually seen after the epithelial displacement, usually seen after the infarct, after the duct rupture, or maybe after the biopsy. And the clue is always is to, you see whether there is a granulation tissue around it, or whether there is any needle track changes, or whether there is hemosiderin laden macrophages, cholesterol cleft, and squamous metaplasia. And of course, if there is myoepithelial cell, then we are safe. Then we can tell it as, it's nothing but it's a pseudo-invasive growth or epithelial displacement. So that is about intraductal papilloma. Now we will see about the next entity, that is papillary DCIS. So this is the last image where the entire papillae has undergone neoplastic process. So what happens is, we don't see the myoepithelial cell. However, the periphery of the lesion will stain for myoepithelial markers. Papillary DCIS, it can diffusely involve the smaller medium sized ducts. It's a subtype of DCIS. And peripheral duct involvement, if there is peripheral duct, they can usually, you know, you can see them as microcalcifications on mammogram, and commonly seen in postmenopausal women. And macroscopically, sometimes they will be very difficult to identify if they're, very small, grossly. However, you can see if they're a little large, you can see some areas of induration. So what is papilloma with DCIS and what is papillary DCIS? In papilloma with DCIS, some part is definitely a benign papilloma is already there and some part of it has become, a neoplastic transformed into malignant. That is papilloma with DCIS. Whereas in papillary DCIS, the entire papillae itself has, it's a part of neoplastic process. So what is this? So I just wanted to, highlight this. Left side, you can see that it's almost, the papillae are very obvious. You can see they are almost pink. Whereas in the right side, you can see they're very bluish. And you don't see such obvious course. Instead, as we see it in the intraductal papilloma. So that is how I wanted to, it is more of pinkish, the intraductal papilloma, whereas it's more of blue or hyperchromatic due to hyperchromatic nucleus. That is in case of this is picture of that papillary DCIS, which is more blue in color. Coming to high power, how is the morphology? Is that you can see this is the papillae, the fine fibrovascular septae. It's not very obvious like how we see in intraductal papilloma. And how are the nucleus arranged? They are arranged as a nuclear, they are stratified. They are hyperchromatic, they are stratified, and the papillae, they are abutted by these epithelial cells. And if you see carefully, you don't see any the myoepithelial cells. However, you can see them in the periphery. So these peripheral cells, I don't know if it is clear in the image, you can see the myoepithelial cells. They can also undergo a little bit of sclerosis or hyalinization as seen in this image. The next is, this I have taken from WHO. Again, this is what I was telling. They will have a very clear cut or punched out spaces. And when you do a CK 5x6, only the peripheral, myoepithelial cells take up. However, the epithelial cells do not take up this CK 5x6, which is a high molecular weight cytokeratin. Now, what has happened here? Do we see this? Two types of cell population, isn't it? One is here and here. So, this is the papillae. And it is not the two types. It's instead that these papillae epithelium itself, they have undergone certain changes. That is, it has become clear to amphiphilic cytoplasm. And so it looks like it has two types of population. There's nothing but a globoid cell change which can occur in this lesions. And how do you say it is the same epithelial changes? Do the stains. And when you do the stain, CK7 has also taken up by the entire papillae. And you might think whether this clear cells myoepithelial cells. But when you do the CK14, only the peripheral myoepithelial cells have taken up and not those cells. So basically, it is nothing but the change that occurs in the epithelial cell. They're the same cells which has undergone a little bit of changes, the globoid cell change. The morphology. The same thing I have written here, that is the neoplastic papillae, they are lined by neoplastic epithelium without intervening myoepithelial layer. What we know is the myoepithelial cells are present at the periphery of the duct space and they have single uniform population. And when you grade these lesions, any lesions in this, whatever I'm speaking, they graded based on their nuclear features. So how you grade the DCIS, the similar way they'll be graded, that is a nuclear grade which is low. You call it low when it is, round, monomorphic, and it is even. And it is high when it is large, pleomorphic, and it has, a nucleoli. However, if you find something in intermediate, you put them in between, you put them in intermediate. So this is how the nuclear is graded. And so usually these lesions are neoplastic, they are low to intermediate grade. So you can see here that... you can also see a little bit of calcification in these areas and these, punched out spaces along with the papillary lesions and the papillary areas can also show calcifications. And when you do a P63 stain, only the peripheral myoepithelial has taken up the stain. In the papillae, they are neoplastic and they do not take up the P63 or myoepithelial markers. So when you call, there is what is microinvasion and what is the criteria for microinvasion? And microinvasion is when you see one or more foci of invasion, none of them should measure more than 1 millimeter. Okay, so when there should not be less than 1 millimeter, you call it microinvasion. And usually, but however, if a malignancy is arising from the papillary DCIS, it's usually intraductal, that is IDC itself. And so that is, and when you see a proper invasive component, the staging has to be done according to this invasive component, the T stage. Again, the papillary DCIS with sclerosis can mimic invasion on coronary biopsies. So this is what I was telling. So see, this is a papilloma and it has undergone sclerosis. The papillary DCIS, and it has undergone sclerosis. And you can use the myoepithelial stains like P63, smooth muscle myosin heavy chain, and CK5x6, which is, you know, stains only the periphery of the cells here, the periphery of the lesion. The, you know, small, the round contour, as well as this helps us to differentiate it from the malignants. Staging papillary DCIS are always staged as like ductal carcinoma in situ, that is DIS in the 8th edition. And when there is a malignancy, that is in papillary DCIS, the risk of breast carcinoma increases to 5 to 7-fold. So that is about papillary DCIS. So the next thing that we will speak is encapsulated papillary carcinoma. Encapsulated papillary carcinoma, it's also considered to be a variant of DCIS. It's seen especially in older women, that is mean age being around 69 to 70 years. And the clinical feature is they present with a bloodstained nipple discharge. And radiological features, they will have a well-defined mammographic lesion. They can have a microcalcification. And usually they are known to have this indolent behavior. Half of them are known to have adjacent DCIS components. So this is associated with the increased local recurrence. So these lesions can have local recurrence because half of them, that is because half of them can show adjacent DCIS component. And 1/3 of them are reported to have this invasive carcinoma. So when it comes to the microscopy, you have this, it's a encapsulated, so you can see a proper capsule, and then you can see the papillae within it. So it is an encapsulated papillary carcinoma. It's and friable with the cystic mass. This is the microscopic feature. So I hope you notice the cyst here, the capsule here, and this is a cyst here, and then there is a lesion here. So similar in the high power, that you can see the capsule, and this is the entire papillae, which is, you know, neoplastic. Coming to high power, there will be this is again the same thing, where the periphery, there is a cyst, it's encapsulated, and you can see the papillary fronds, which is neoplastic, and there are no myoepithelial cells present in the papillae as well as at the periphery of the lesion. They will be similar. They will have hyperchromatic nucleus. They'll have a very, you know, this is the fibrovascular septae. They will have the nuclear stratification, hyperchromasia, and low to intermediate grade nucleus. When you do a stain for IHC for myoepithelial cells, the center, the periphery, as well as the papillae do not take up, there will be no myoepithelial cells in this lesion. So basically, there will be a capsule, and inside that, there will be a papillae, which is neoplastic. You can grade them again, I told you before, right? Isn't it the nuclear features based on like how you grade the DCIS component? Similarly, they you have to grade here based on the nuclear features, and they're managed and staged as PTIs, that is in situ carcinomas. And if there is any malignancy, like if there is an invasive component, then you know the staging you have to give according to the how you do it any other like conventional carcinomas. The T stage should be the size of this invasive component. And usually, the, as I said, the nucleus is low to high grade. However, 3% of the cases, they are shows high grade features. And that is seen, you know, younger age of presentation, that is around 58 years. And these can be triple negative tumors. Normally, the papillary, you know, these encapsulated papillary carcinomas are ER positive. Whereas these 3% of the cases, which shows high grade features, they can be ER negative and or triple negatives. And this is known to have, you know, a high recurrence as well as metastasis. So this kind of lesions should not be managed as in situ carcinomas, whereas it has to be managed like any other conventional carcinomas. IHCs, when you do the myoepithelial markers, as I said before, it will be negative at the periphery as well as the lining of the fibrovascular core. ER is usually positive and HER2 is negative. Outcome, older studies, they said the larger tumors require mastectomy, and some patients also had lymph nodes and distant metastasis. But recent literature says that it has an indolent behavior, and you know, based on the advancement in the therapy, clinical outcome is very excellent. It's excellent with adequate local therapy, like just like that of DCIs. So that is about the encapsulated papillary carcinoma. So the next thing we're talking about is solid papillary carcinomas. That is, we have an in situ and an invasive component here. And solid papillary carcinoma, the name itself describes, it has a solid growth pattern and a very fine, delicate fibrovascular course. Localization, any part of the breast may be affected, but central and subalar area is affected most commonly, and it is seen in postmenopausal women as a palpable mass. It can have a bloody nipple discharge. It's known to have this neuroendocrine differentiation and also known to have mucin production, which can be intracellular or it can be extracellular. It can have an invasive component, that is most commonly is the conventional carcinoma in IDC, and also it can have a mucinous carcinoma associated with the solid papillary carcinoma. So grossly, as you see here, you can see some marked here, that is some, you know, lobulated areas, fleshy appearance from fleshy nodular areas. Coming to the microscopy, so when you see in LOPAR, what you can appreciate in the LOPAR is that they have solid nest. So the name itself describes solid nest, and I'm not sure you can appreciate here, there's some fibrovascular core that will go to hyper, and nest, see the nest, they have very rounded and regular contours. It's not irregular. They have round regular contours. They do not have any irregular edges. The hyper image, see, this is how the papillae, they have a very fine, it's not that conspicuous, it's not obvious like the papillomas. They have this fine papillae, I'm sorry, fibrovascular core with polarized cells around it. And then you have the solid nest of this monotonous proliferation of cells, which almost has like DCIS like nuclear features. So this is the intracellular, you know, mucin, which looks like, which has a signet ring like appearance. So it has intracellular mucin, and it's also known to have these spindled areas, spindled morphology. So hyper, as I said before, that is, you know, they have monotonous, they have monoclonal proliferation, hyperchromatic monotonous cells, hyperchromatic nucleus with eosinophilic cytoplasm with this delicate fibrovascular core. And this also shows some hyalinized areas. Again, the same high power image. See this very delicate, fine fibrovascular core with polarized cells around it. And see the nuclear features. It's hyperchromatic, low to intermediate grade, and can have some variable mitosis. This is mucin. So this is the area of extracellular mucin. However, if you see a lot of mucin and you see some cells floating on it, you also have to consider a possibility of mucinous carcinoma. This is what I said, they can have, they can sometimes have a more spindled appearance as well. When you do the IHCs, their nest, isn't it? So high molecular weight cytokeratins is not present in the epithelial cells, but the myoepithelial cells, they can be present at the periphery of the nest. So nest can have this myoepithelial along at the periphery. But it's not a hard and fast rule. So if you don't see myoepithelial cell, it doesn't mean it's invasive. So that is what we should remember here. They're strongly and diffusely positive for ER-PR. They do not show HER2 overexpression. Ki-67 proliferation is usually low to intermediate grade. And neuroendocrine differentiation, as I said before, can be demonstrated by synaptophysin or chromocrine, which is usually, you know, associated with the, if there is a mucinous component, the neuroendocrine differentiation is more pronounced. So this is a picture that shows a high molecular weight cytokeratin, which is present at the periphery of the nest here, which stains the myoepithelial cells. And this is synaptophysin and this is chromocranin, which demonstrate the neuroendocrine feature of this lesions. And ER is diffusely positive. It's a nuclear grade. And the grading can be done, you know, how we grade the conventional carcinomas. One important thing that I want to stress here is solid, when do you call it in situ and when do you call it invasive? So in situ is when the nodules are rounded, they have a well-circumscribed contours. Okay, the contour, they have well-circumscribed and you do not see any irregular jigsaw-like areas. Then that is when you call it invasive. And this is regardless whether you see a myoepithelial cell layer present at the periphery of the nodule using the myoepithelial stains. If you do use the IHC for myoepithelial cell and you do not see the myoepithelial marker at the periphery of the nodules, it doesn't mean that the lesion is invasive. So this is one image where you can see some irregular areas, isn't it? The rounded contour is gone. You can see some irregular areas. And this is how you tell it as invasive solid papillary carcinoma. So this is very rare. The normal invasion will be IDC component itself. The solid papillary carcinoma itself invasive component is very, very rare. However, you have to consider that when there it's a very large tumor size, you can see irregular jigsaw-like pattern and you see perineural invasion or you see it's invading the skeletal muscle underneath, or these lesions sometimes, you know, can present with metastasis to the lymph node. Normally, they do not have any these nests definitely they do not have myoepithelial cells at the periphery. And if you see a lot of mucin, you can think of mucin as carcinoma. And normally the invasive component usually is of this carcinoma of no special type or lobular. It can be tubular or cribriform carcinoma, but the invasive carcinoma, solid papillary carcinoma, is rare, but it has an excellent prognosis. So this is the area which, you know, it is infiltrating and it is having a desmoplastic reaction around the stroma. This is a solid papillary carcinoma which is invading the skeletal muscle. So this is a skeletal muscle and it is showing the evidence of invasion. So this is invasive solid papillary carcinoma. And when you do a myoepithelial cells stain, it will not stain there is no staining of myoepithelial cells at the periphery. CK5/6 is high molecular weight and it's not taken up by this nest. However, this will not rule out that if it is not present, you shouldn't consider it as invasive, but it helps us to aid our diagnosis. Molecular pathology, a few copy number aberrations including 16q loss, 16p gains and 1q gains have been noted, and 43% of the cases shows PIK3CA mutations. And it has lower expression of genes compared to the IDCs. So the next is staging. How do you stage this? Again, these tumors are staged as in situ, that is DCIS, TPTIS staged itself, and they graded according to the nuclear features, like how we grade the DCIS. And if the invasion is present, you always have to tell about the invasive component only, not the entire solid papillary carcinoma. Only the invasive component has to be used for de-staged. And you can do that invasive component, you can do the regular our Nottingham grading and the receptor status, which we regularly do for other conventional carcinomas in the breast. So again, I want to stress the point that in the absence of any obvious conventional invasive carcinomas, solid papillary carcinomas are staged as PTIS, that is in situ. It's in situ disease, regardless of whether myoepithelial cell layer is present or not. The last entity that we have here is invasive papillary carcinoma. So invasive papillary carcinoma, it's very, very rare, and its etiology and pathogenesis is unknown. And it shows a frank invasive lesion with the papillae, which has a fibrovascular core, and it is lined by the neoplastic epithelium. There is absolutely no myoepithelial cell in these cases. And microscopic, it can show solid fleshy appearance that may be friable. So as you know, any papillary lesion, they usually have this friable appearance. You can see here an invasive lesion and you can see in the microscopy high power that it is, you know, obvious, it looks outright malignant. There is invasion and there is no myoepithelial layer present throughout this lesion. And you can use the similar SPR grading. Now, what is this? What is this lesion? You can see a lesion which is, you know, there is a papillae, but it's not an outgo to high power. Okay, so it is not an obvious papillary. It's just that the cells look like they have been a papillae and they're arranged like this morules, and they're, you know, they're having this empty spaces around it. And if you see the nuclear, they have this inside out pattern. That is, the nucleus is outside and the lumina is inside. So it has an inside out pattern, and this doesn't have a papillae. And this is one of the differential diagnoses that can come in along with the papillary lesion of breast, and that is invasive micropapillary carcinoma, which will be dealt in detail in the next class. Another differential, so when you do an EMA staining, it will, you know, highlight the peripheral accentuation, like the periphery of this will show increased intensity for EMA stain. So what is this? This is another differential diagnosis which can occur in the case of, which we'll also have to consider, that is, but we see two types of cells here, isn't it? One is clear, this is one type of cell which has become, which shows clear cytoplasm. This is another type of cell which shows epithelial. So it is having a, you know, epithelial component in the form of a gland. This is another differential diagnosis that has to be considered, that is adenomyoepithelioma, which is can show papillary areas and might also have to be considered as a differential in the papillary lesion of the breast. This is another entity which is recently added. What is this? This is again showing a solid pattern having a very fine fibrovascular septae. But when you see the nucleus, you know, they are tall, they're columnar like cells, and they're having this reverse polarity. So this is a new entity which is added in WHO as a separate entity, that is a tall cell carcinoma with reverse polarity. And yeah, that will be taken in the breast malignant cases. So this is the high power image of the cell. See the nucleus which is having the reverse polarity, they are tall and columnar. So summarizing the all our, you know, whatever we have discussed, that is introductory papilloma, papilloma with DCIS. How is it? That is introductory papilloma, they, as I told, it will be a little blue, pinkish. They have a very obvious papillae. They will have both neoplasm, that is, they will have both epithelial and myoepithelial cells, but they can undergo usual ductal hyperplasia. Some changes that can occur is apocrine metaplasia or sebaceous change also can occur. And if you do a myoepithelial cell staining, it will be present throughout the papillae. Next is papilloma with ADH or DCIS. There will be a monoclonal proliferation of one part of epithelial component. And they will also have papillae, and that area of ADH or DCIS will not stain for myoepithelial markers. And then you have a papillary DCIS where the entire papillae has undergone a neoplastic process. So the myoepithelial markers will be absent in the papillae, where will they be taken at the periphery of the lesion. The next is encapsulated papillary carcinoma, where it is present in a capsule. It is encapsulated, and then you have a papillary inside. The papillae itself is neoplastic, and the myoepithelial cells will not be present in the periphery as well as in the papillary fronts. Then solid papillary carcinoma. This is, there'll be solid nest. The papillae is not that conspicuous, like it's not that obvious, and they will have intermediate to low to intermediate grade, and they can have neuroendocrine or mismatch differentiation. When you do the myoepithelial stains, it will be present in the, you know, in the periphery, can be present at the periphery of the nest. They will have a smooth regular contours, and if you see irregular areas, it means it's invasion. Then you have invasive papillary carcinoma, which is very, very rare, and the myoepithelial cell, it will not be present throughout the papillae. So these are the myoepithelial markers that you can use, and that is how, you know, the staining, as I explained before. And what is the use of high molecular weight cytokeratin? It is that it will be useful especially to differentiate UDH from atypical ductal hyperplasia. One thing we have to remember is this high molecular weight cytokeratin will be negative when there is an apocrine metaplasia. And then in papillary disease, ER pair is usually, you know, strong, positive, strong and diffuse in most of the cases. Solid papillary carcinoma can have extra, that is neuroendocrine differentiation, which is demonstrated by chromogranin and synaptopysin. So these are my books that I referred, you know, for pictures. And yes, thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Swati. Excellent presentation, very crisp and very confident. Very nicely done.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Now let us see if there are any questions.
I'll try to answer it to my best.
No, no issues. There is no problem. You can.
Yeah.
We can even send you the questions and answer them on the Telegram group later.
Okay, sir,
There is no hurry. I mean, we are not here taking anybody's exam. It is a process of teaching, you know. So we are all here to learn.
Yes.
So since there are no questions here on the Google Meet, there are some questions which I will, which are there in the YouTube. I will just read out one of them. And is Dr. Pranab Kumar Bhattacharya, professor from Calcutta. He has asked a question. Breast lesions which are diagnosed as benign papilloma on core needle biopsy, how much of them has a risk of being malignant?
So papilloma, 2 to 3 times, if there you don't find any component which is atypical. But the risk will become 5 to 7 times if you see any atypical areas or any DCIS or ADH component.
Fine, that's fine. Now, there is another question by Dr. Bhattacharya, that is on BRCA carrier status. I think that question, we will take it up in the next when we are dealing with malignant lesions and DCIS. That
yes,
we will check it up then. There is another question by Dr. Bhattacharya, role of tumor infiltrating lymphocytes in stroma of high-grade DCIS. That also, I don't think so, will be relevant at this point.
Yes.
We will take it up next time. I will put up these questions on the Telegram group. So if anybody is interested, they can answer it there. Very well done, Dr. Swati Prabhu. Very nicely presented. God bless you.
Thank you
so much for all that effort, and the pictures and the explanation were very good, very crisp, very nice. God bless you. Okay, then we close the session here. Good night, everybody. Take care. Bye-bye.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Bye.